last number of years, but I really was fascinated by the John Grisham element of this show, and I really like the movie very much. I think Cruise's performance is excellent, and I thought the idea that Grisham says about the genesis of this series, which is that he had been asked more than any other question in his entire career, what happened to Mitch McDeer and his family. And so the idea of setting a television show apart from the book and apart from the movie 10 years later, after they've been through witness protection and can touch on some of the things that they had gone through in that 10 years, but then also set it out where they're, you know, trying to live normal lives. And obviously, Mitch McDeer is not great at choosing a job. he's got pretty bad luck. so therein lies the Grisham elements of it.
So I guess the obvious question is, how much running do you do on the show, and how much physical, action is in on the show?
You know, it got to a point where they really tried to limit my running because they realized, like, he can't run 12 hours a day, but maybe he can run 10. Well, 10's too much, so what about 8? So I really was running about 8 hours a day, and I'm serious, I was beaten up. I'm sure not having to work out. I'm sure not having to exercise other than the show. But it's, you know, the show does take place primarily in, a courtroom. And so those sections are obviously rather sedentary, so it's kind of an interesting mix where the show goes from being very much, you know, a legal show, and then moments of, you know, tremendous, hopefully thrilling action. The inherent icon of John Grisham is the lawyer with a briefcase running, and so I think a lot of it is that I ask questions like, why doesn't he have a car, you know? why can't he get a Ferrari? But I'm running a lot, that's for sure.
I've always wondered, where did the easy dent in your name come from?
My parents were, pretty hardcore anti-nuclear activist radicals who lived for a period of time on an Indian reservation and were very good friends. My father's still very good friends with a man who is a Navajo kind of priest, I guess. He's a shaman, and he's a very, very brilliant guy. And you name your baby based on the birth. So I came out very easy, and so easy that I sort of popped out, and they smashed my head on a bedpost and gave me a big dent. So, dent.
Seriously?
For real, yeah. That's it.
Nice.
Yeah.
Josh, you had a nice turn. You're having a nice turn this season as Charles Lindbergh in J. Edgar. And the next film we'll see when you're Neil Cassady?
Yeah, Neil Cassady was a really interesting character, to say the least. He's anyone who's seen, I think it's the Alex Gibney film, Ken Kesey's story, like, Cassady was a madman. I mean, he is the inspiration of the whole Beat generation. Every one of these artists, I mean, you're talking major people from Kerouac to Ken Kesey to the Grateful Dead, you know, all say that Cassady was the inspiration for who and why they did what they did, because his sort of free-form language abilities, his poetry that sort of poured out of him, even though he wasn't able to capture it as an artist, he definitely inspired other artists. So it's a really interesting film, which is the story of the last moments of Kerouac's sort of alcohol-fueled madness, where he goes alone into Big Sur, and we stayed and shot exactly in the place that he was in, and it's the first film that has complete support from the Kerouac family and foundation, and it's done really interesting, beautiful film.
Were you familiar with Kerouac and the Beats before this, or did you have to do your own work?
You know, I was, actually. I wasn't as familiar as I would like to have been, and particularly then became over a period of time. I mean, the writing is astonishing. And it's also a really beautiful, interesting book, because it's not the sort of great, oh, we're the cool Beat generation. Big Sur is very much after that. Big Sur is sort of the fallout of what happened. And Cassady... You know, Cassady and Kerouac obviously were not only best friends, but sort of intimately involved in love triangles, all sorts of different things going on between them and the women in their lives, and that they were pretty much falling apart at that point. Fascinating people.
Nice, can't wait.
You know, was there a moment in time when you realized that acting was the course of your career, the course of your life?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. It was really early on. I mean, my father is an emergency room doctor, and he basically said to me very early on, you have to pursue this the same way that I have pursued being a doctor, and you can't do it like thinking, I'll give this 5 years. You know, it was really like, you know, no doctor goes into it thinking, all right, I'll give this 5 years. And so there was a real sense early on for me that was the dedication that I had to pursue it with, and the level of constantly... You know, great athletes, great doctors, you know, anyone who's great at their job, oftentimes they're, you know, training and retraining themselves consistently. And that's been something that I really took from my father, is that there's consistently, you need to, you know, keep up to date in terms of how you pursue your work.
Conversely, was there a moment in time when you realized that you'd achieved the goal, that you'd become the actor that you wanted to be?
No, I don't feel that. Not, you know, and I'm not being coy about this, what I've found interesting about that, and it's a good question, is that I've felt quite the opposite. I felt consistently like the more I understand the job, the more I feel humbled by it, and the more I feel it is remarkably both fascinating and difficult. I mean, you know, our job is to play human beings, right? And human beings are always more flawed, more complex, more... Charles Lindbergh is a perfect example. I mean, here's a man who's one of the most complex people in American society, and that had, you know, was the greatest hero, and then had the world completely turn against him. And what is fascinating, even to take it to Mitch McDear, is here's a character who was on top of the world, who, you know, consistently makes these very unfortunate and naive mistakes that get him into severe trouble, and that those, the way that they play out, and hopefully trying to bring a level of integrity of what would really go on in someone's life when they're, you know, dealing with facing having their family shot. I mean, it's terrifying.
Any concerns at all about reinventing, rebooting a character that was in a blockbuster movie and everybody has seen as Tom Cruise?
What I did feel more than anything was a need to homage what Tom Cruise did. I really think his work is excellent in that film. It's a great film, actually. In many ways, that film takes that book and heightens and elevates it and grounds it all at the same time. And so I felt like, for me, it was not to try and fill the shoes. It was to try and make sure that, obviously I set it aside and made it my own, but that I did have moments that referenced and paid homage to what I think the film and what Cruise and what the book, the character, the essence of the character is in the book too. But what's interesting to me, and what I think John Grisham is fascinated by, is that these characters are not the same as the book or the movie. That this 10 years has been deeply difficult, deeply damaging, and that they are, you know, like life, they are more broken and more paranoid and more. They're, you know, he's not the guy. If you look at Cruise's performance in the beginning of that movie, he is on top of the world. I mean, he is the, you know, has the cock of, you know, the guy, you know. He's coming out of Harvard, you know, with every option. And at this point in his life, they have very little options. They have no money and not much going for them.
As I remember, and I could be way wrong on this, but wasn't the ending in the movie entirely different than the ending in the book?
Yes, it is.
So is this show following the ending from the book or the movie?
You know, it's a great question, and I think what it does more follows the movie, but it's interesting because what they do is they follow strands of the movie more and then strands of the book more. So and I think that's what, when I say they're trying to set it apart and yet reference both, it sort of frees it up, because in the end of the movie, he busts the mafia, right? And he busts the law firm without taking down the mafia. And so it's in the book, they get away on a sailboat. In this case, it's kind of a mix of the two, where they don't get away, yet they do go into witness protection, so they do not... It's a perfect mix, I would say, is what it is.
But really, the bulk book of your career has been in film, but with the lead of television, obviously, a lot more filming. Do you like that pace? It's a faster pace.
Well, one of the things I love about independent film is that there is a similar pace to independent film and television. The difference is that you do get a break after a movie, and the movies usually, I mean, look, we shot Big Stir in 3 weeks, so it's a full 2-hour movie in 3 weeks. We shot the pilot for The Firm in about 3 weeks as well. The thing that I have experienced, which has been both tremendously challenging and sort of an amazing test, is that I will have done in this 10 months of shooting The Firm as much material as I will have done in the last decade of my career. And I've been lucky and worked tremendously and a lot in the last decade, so that's, you know, that's saying that consistently the undertaking of television, particularly being the lead of a one-hour drama, is a it's a massive undertaking. It's a marathon. I've had multiple people sort of prepare me for it who I know who've done it. Anthony Edwards, who did ER, Bryan Cranston, obviously, who's done it, and obviously he's a little different because he's now on a 13-episode show. But there's a big difference between that too.
When you look at what Tom did with your character in the film, it was almost a machine gun delivery of dialogue. Obviously, if the character is aged 10 years, is there a relaxing of the delivery, the pace of the lines?
Well, there might be a relaxing of the pace or the delivery. You know, obviously, those are things that Cruz and I are different. You know, that he's there's the ambition of the character is different in the beginning of his career in life than it is at this point, and that I wanted to hopefully make a clear delineation between the two. But I will say the drive, the sort of desperate need to do the right thing is an inherent John Grisham, deeply important element to Mitch McDear that I think both, you know, Cruz did really, really well. But I do think that there's a much more broken element to this character. He's much more damaged now. He's much more flawed, I think.
Could you just tell us, aren't you engaged now?
I am, yeah.
Could you tell that, what you told him?
Last night was on the Jay Leno show, and the true story of how I got engaged is that I was staying in Big Sur making the movie and staying up in a little tiny trailer up in a long hike up a dirt road. And one night we got dropped off 3 o'clock in the morning after shooting, my girlfriend at the time and I, and we hiked up this hill, and it's a serious hike. I mean, there's a cliff to your side, and it's very, very dark, and we got to the trailer after this long hike up 3 o'clock in the morning, and she, you know, kind of, we burst in and both kind of exhausted and excited to be there because it was a little intense, the hike, to say the least, at that time of night in that darkness. And she immediately started hyperventilating and saying that she had been terrified that she was about to be attacked by a mountain lion. And I, you know, kind of dismissed her and said, look, there's no mountain lions up here, don't worry about it. The next day I go to work, she stayed in the trailer that day. The next day I went to work, and there were signs all over this house about what to do in case you saw a mountain lion. So I was like, oh, wow.